Good evening. On behalf of the Chennai International Centre, it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you here today. Today is our 11th event. The CIC team has worked very hard to organise interesting events across different subjects, and I'm sure today's event will also be extremely interesting and engaging. It's my privilege to introduce to you our speakers tonight. So first, let me start with Mr. Glenn McGrath. Glenn is the most successful bowler in the history of Test cricket. Five hundred sixty-three wickets in 15 years. It's an outstanding record. But also, needless to say, Glenn's not the most popular person in India. After all, he's the one who got Sachin out in the first over in the 2003 World Cup in South Africa. And how can we forget the Test match in Adelaide in 1999, where Glenn convinced the umpire to give Sachin out leg before wicket when the ball actually hit his shoulder. And it was going way above the stumps. So Glenn, we don't forget these things. Yeah. But needless to say, I've been fortunate to work with Glenn closely for the last 4 years. And you won't meet a more down-to-earth and humble person. He's been extremely committed and very professional in his work with the MRF Pace Foundation. And I think his contribution will go a long way in developing Indian cricket. So thank you very much, Glenn, for agreeing to be with us today. We're also very fortunate to have with us here Mr. N. Ram. He, of course, needs no introduction to all of us here in Chennai. Apart from being one of India's most outstanding journalists, what I found fascinating about Mr. N. Ram is his passion and love for the game of cricket. I was fortunate to go to his house last week, and he showed me his library, where he had books of all the great international cricketers for the last 100 years. So in fact, I warned Glenn that there's a good chance that Mr. Ram might know more about his record than himself. So, and I advised him to brush up on his stats before he's come here. So I saw Glenn quickly scanning through his own Wikipedia file. So I'm sure today will be an engaging session. So over to you, Mr. Ram.
Don't believe all this. Vijay Amritraj the other day, and now cricket, and I believe you have something for chess coming down the road. Glenn, you've been praised for bringing to your bowling during a distinguished 14-year test career, for bringing to it a high degree of cricket intelligence. Is there something called cricket intelligence? And if yes, could you name a few people you played with or against whom you admired for their cricket intelligence? Is there such a thing?
Yeah. Well, so firstly, thank you for the invitation along here and welcome along. It's a nice little compliment to say that I have intelligence. Being a fast bowler, it's all the batsmen say, oh, the fast bowlers aren't very intelligent. But let me tell you, we're the most intelligent ones in the game. It's a bloke standing down the other end with a cricket bat when you've got guys running in bowling 100 mile an hour at you, less intelligent. But to be honest, cricket intelligence, I think, is something that most international cricketers have in some degree. And you see the guys who are classed the greats of the game will have probably a higher cricket intelligence. And by what we mean by that, it's about the awareness of what's happening in the match and the way they go about it, what needs to be done at certain times to ensure that your team does well. I think anyone who's classed the great of the game, you know, your Sachin Tendulkars, your Brian Laras, those guys definitely have cricket intelligence. A lot of players in India here, Saurav Ganguly, captain for a while. You need, I think, cricket intelligence to be a captain. Rahul Dravid, VVS Lakshman, just to name a few. But in our team, I was lucky enough to play in the era of Australian cricket that was pretty amazing, where any one of the players out in the middle could win the game for you. And the captains I played under, from Alan Border, Mark Taylor, Steve Warren, and finally Ricky Ponting, were all very, had a high level of cricket intelligence and the way they went about the game, the way they used their senior players to help. But if I had to choose one person that to think cricket intelligence, the guy that I played with, which is probably one of the highest levels, would be a guy who never captained Australia, but probably should have, just the, what he got got up to off the field probably didn't hold him in good stead. But the guy I'm talking about is Shane Warne. And Warney, you know, he just knew the game so well. He was a showman, very much a showman. He loved the big moments. You know, he loved getting to the last ball of the day and then stopping play and getting the wicketkeeper come down, make a big scene, put more pressure on the batsman, and then, you know, come in. And a lot of times he actually got a wicket off the last ball, and just the way he went about his cricket. So to me, you know, Shane Warne was very, had a very high level of cricket intelligence, very street smart, went out in the middle.
Best captain Australia never had.
Best captain Australia never had, probably definitely Shane Warne. Yeah, Warney did go over and play county cricket for Hampshire, and he captain coached there for quite some time. And what he did for that club, he really brought a different attitude to the club, and they went out and they played good, aggressive, positive cricket and did extremely well under Shane. And though I never got to captain Warney in test matches, he did captain for a few one-day matches when Steve Waugh was injured. And I'm a big rap for Warney as captain, but the only thing I'd say against Shane was his only issue would he would over-captain when he played. And I remember there was a one-day game at the SCG. We played England. He was captain, and I was bowling, and I'd just taken the ninth wicket. And Alan Mullally walks out. And if you remember, Alan Mullally, left arm swing bowler and a right-hand batsman. And when it comes to batting, he makes me look like Sir Donald Bradman. So he's pretty ordinary when it comes to, he makes me look like Sachin Tendulkar when it comes to batting. But so Alan Mullally comes out to bat, and he takes centre, and I'm ready to run in and bowl. We need one more wicket to win. They need four more runs to win. And so Warney stops from first slip. He runs all the way down to where I am at the top of my mark, and he comes up to me and he says, "Pidge," my nickname's Pidge, and he comes, "Pidge, this guy is not very good. The ball you need to bowl is the reverse in-swinging Yorker." You know, the ball was old. It was reverse swinging. He's got the ball you need to bowl, reverse in-swinging Yorker. And I said, "Warney," I said, "what else am I going to bowl?" And so Warney's happy. He's run all the way back to first slip where he's fielding. The game had stopped for about 5 or 6 minutes, and finally we can start again because Warney's ready. I run in, bowl the ball, comes out pretty well. Good reverse, a reverse in-swinging Yorker. Alan Mullally gets nowhere near it. Stumps everywhere. Bowl, we win by 4 runs. We're running around pretty happy we've won the game, and Warney comes up to me and goes, "I told you so." So that would be the only negative comment I'd have to say. He would overcap, but he was good fun.
Now the bowler captain is almost an extinct species. You have Jason Holder captaining the West Indies, a team sadly in decline in both tests and ODI, but other than that, why?
I never had any, I never wanted to be captain of the team. And I'm not sure the fast bowler is the best person to captain of the team. Not because he can't, because I think he can. He knows the game very well. But when you're out bowling, you want to be able to focus exactly on what you're doing in the middle. And the captains that I've seen who are fast bowlers have either bowled themselves too much or not enough. And so you need to be not only thinking about your over, you need to be thinking about who's bowling next and how the game's situated, where, what needs to be done. So that's why I always think a batsman is better for that role, because when they're batting, they only have to focus on batting. They don't have to think about, you know, changing the field or anything coming up. So, and then when they're in the field, you know, they get a bit bored. So, you know, our captains, you know, Mark Taylor's a good example. He would field at first slip. So he's got nothing else to do except watch the ball and maybe take the odd catch. So just to keep them interested in the game, if they're made captain, then they can think about what's coming up and who should be bowling next and where the game's heading, and it allows a fast bowler to concentrate exactly on what he needs to achieve, that ball, that over. And I think the guys who have done that, that allows a fast bowler to perform at his best, and I think that's the best option for the team.
Now, you played under four captains, Alan Border, Mark Taylor, Steve Waugh and Ricky Ponting. Who would you rate as the best and why?
Very hard decision. You know, I was very lucky with the captains I got to play under when I first made the team. Alan Border was captain. And AB, his, I guess, philosophy or attitude was to get into a position to win before you go for a win. Now, he took over the Australian team when they were pretty ordinary and really built the team up along with Bob Simpson, who was a coach, up until one of the best teams in the world. But his attitude was, okay, let's make sure we can't lose this game before we go for a win. Mark Taylor, who I think is a very astute captain, took over quite a good team. And he brought a different philosophy. He said, now let's go for a win from ball one. A more aggressive form, more positive form of the game, which I prefer. So then he hands over a very good team to Steve Waugh. Steve Waugh not only wanted us to go for a win from ball one, he wanted us to crush the opposition from ball one. His favourite word was ruthless. He didn't want to give the other team any chance at all. And then poor old Ricky Ponting, where do you take the team from there? But I thought Rick did a very good job. He took over a really good team, lost 7 senior players in a 2-year period, and the team still did pretty well. He won 2 World Cups as captain, and in 2004 he was captain here when we won in India for the first time in a long, long time. So out of all them, I thought it's hard to pick who was, I would say, was the best captain, because I think they took the team to a different level. But I've been asked numerous times to write down or to choose my Australian 11 of the players I've played with. And I've always been a bit hesitant to do that. Not so much who I'd pick, but who I'd leave out. I always found more difficult.
And hurt their feelings?
Every guy I played with, I had respect for and loved playing alongside him. And so it was tough leaving players out. But I finally named my 11 or 12. And I picked 3 of those captains in the team. Unfortunately for Mark Taylor, he got left out. I chose Matty Hayden instead as my opener. But I picked Alan Border, Steve Waugh and Ricky Ponting in the team. And I made Alan Border captain. And if you ask Mark Taylor, Steve Waugh or Ricky Ponting who should have been captain, they would all say Alan Border.
Now, technical question. Slightly technical question. There seem to be 2 approaches to helping pace bowlers develop their skill, strength, longevity. The old school approach was bowl more overs, get stronger, more skillful, more disciplined, develop muscle memory. The current management system, followed by Australia and a few other teams, is to manage fast bowler workloads. That's the buzzword with modern technology, digital data. Data-led monitoring. You told us about some of this and more work in the gym. And your Pat Howard, Cricket Australia's high-performance manager, represents the system. And recently, I read that Jeff Thompson was quoted as saying, and I quote, "What's this high-performance stuff? The bowlers, you just got to get out there and bowl." Is there a balance to be struck, or do you prefer one approach to the other?
No. The good thing about Jeff Thompson, Tomo always kept it very simple. He just ran in and just let it go at 100 mile an hour or more whenever he could. So his philosophy was very simple. I like both sides of the argument there, because I think bowlers do need to improve their skill. They do need to improve their strength, their fitness, and every level there. It's a bit of a tough one. I personally, the more I bowled, the better I felt. I wonder if they're not playing too much cricket these days. Obviously, there's more different intensity in international cricket now than when I played. I think more so in respects to the T20s. We played more test cricket back then, one day, and I only played 2 international T20s. So during a test match, you get settled in one spot. You can get into your routines. You can recover well, can go to the pool each morning and loosen up, and you get in these routines and you get set, and it's not too bad. T20s, you fly in, play, it's all quick, high intensity, bang, you're on, back to the hotel, to an airport, off the next day. So I think everything that goes with T20s makes it a little bit more difficult, so different intensity in that respect. But I think bowlers need to work hard. There's no substitute for that. The harder you work, the luckier you get, and it's very true. And I wonder how hard the fast bowlers are working off the field, and they need an off-season. They play so much cricket these days, a fast bowler needs an off-season to get fit, get strong again. I sort of related to driving your car. If you keep driving your car, never fill up with fuel, sooner or later you're going to run out of fuel, aren't you? So I probably learnt the hard way myself. I went to the West Indies tour in 1995. I did well on that tour, and it was the first time I cemented my place in the team. Took my first 5 wickets in an innings. We did well in that series, and I cemented my place in the team. But when I came home, I was injured. I torn my intercostal side, one of my side muscles, or grunt muscles, we call them. It's where the fast bowler gets all his power from. And I weighed 77 kilos. So that's only about 26, 27 kilos less than I am now. So there was nothing of me. And I knew if I kept doing what I was doing, I wasn't going to have much longevity in the game. So I went out and found a trainer who was as tough as anyone going around outside the team. And his attitude was to train so much harder than anything you'd ever experience in the middle. And I must say, he achieved that easily. I used to look forward to playing Test cricket or international cricket to have a break. That was, you know, come and play Test cricket here as a fast bowler. I was thinking that was a break to bowl, you know, 20, 25 overs a day. So I think that attitude helped me in good stead. But it's what fast bowlers are prepared to do off the field, you know, to stay strong, to stay fit, and that will hold them in good stead on the field. So it's a balance between working hard in the nets, on your fitness, gym, in the gym, doing the right strength work. I think we tell the young guys at the MRF Pace Foundation, you need to be strong through your core and through your glutes and your legs. But most guys, when they go to the gym these days, they focus on what I call beach muscles. You know, their guns or their arms, they're doing these, they're doing their pecs. So they stand in front of the mirror. They've got big arms, big pecs, and they look and good abs, and they look good. But it doesn't help you being a fast bowler. So you have to do the right weights in the gym to prepare you for fast bowling. So, yeah, technology will play a part, but you've got to find that right balance, and I still don't think they have.
So how would you have felt to be part of a test side that rotated bowlers, if you had been rotated?
I would have said I'm playing. You know, when the toss went up and it was our turn to bowl, there would have been 12 people on the field ready to go. So, I did rotate a little bit in one days. I was never happy to do it, but I felt it was best thing for the team, then so be it. I think it's, especially cricket these days, it's not just about the 11 players out in the middle, it's a squad. And squad of sort of 15, 17 players sometimes. So that's why I was happy to rotate in the one day, is just to keep the whole squad playing, performing at their best. But Test cricket to me was the ultimate, and I wanted to play every single game I could.
Is there a risk of losing form and rhythm when you rotate?
Oh, definitely. I think if you have a week off, week and a half off, not bowling, then you just come off a little bit.
Bowling at that level.
At that level, and it's at the start of a season, it takes a few matches to get in to where you're performing at your best. And that's where you want to stay the whole season. If you have a week and a half, 2 weeks off, you start dipping off, and the next game you've got to build it up. And that's the biggest, to me, that's your biggest risk of getting injured. So I used to like to get to performing at my best and then just keep playing, keep bowling, and doing what I had to do off the field to allow me to play at my best on the field.
Now, looking at the great fast bowlers of our time, I may leave out somebody, but including bowlers of extreme pace and intimidating physical hostility, at least four stand out from the modern era. Fast bowlers who bowled thousands of test overs, collected bagfuls of wickets at a very good average, did not break down as frequently as they seem to be doing these days. And let me illustrate. In chronological sequence, first, Kapil Dev. His test career extended from 1978 to 1994. Played 131 tests, bowled about 2,950 overs in tests. Took 434 wickets, average of 29.64. Kapil never missed a test, except once when he was dropped. The second was Courtney Walsh. Test career, 1984 to 2001, 132 tests, about 5,000 overs, average 24.44. The third was Cuddly Ambrose. Test career, 1988 to 2000, 3,680 overs approximately, 405 wickets, remarkable average 20.99. And the fourth, Hugh. Test career, 1993 to 2007, 124 tests, bowled 29,248 balls, which translates to approximately 4,870. Did you bowl a lot of no balls?
Not too many. And if I had my way, I would have bowled a lot more overs. The captain, in the end, had to drag me off from bowling.
4,870, bagged 563 wickets, averaged 21.64. Not counting the overs, all four of you bowled in ODIs. You had ankle surgery in 2004, trod on a cricket ball at Edgbaston in 2005, with fateful results for Australia. Some say that the Ashes were gone with that mishap. And you had a two-year layoff caring for your wife. So, I mean, what a dramatic contrast. And maybe, I don't know about Wasim Akram, one of the all-time greats, but taking just these four, including yourself, I mean, how do you explain the dramatic contrast between this continuous bowling, and you bowl with great intensity and great success? I think you bowled 53 tests without a break.
Yeah, no, 53 tests in a row before I had to get some surgery in my ankle. I'd grown some spurs on the bone and they were starting to cause problems when I played, so I had to have them removed. But and that was just from bowling over after over. So the guys you mentioned were just, you know, were great to the game. Capel, Courtney Walsh, Curtly Ambrose, you mentioned briefly Wasim Akram, you know, some of the greats of the game. To me, a standout was Courtney Walsh. He played like 21 years of cricket, just straight. He played for the West Indies, then he'd go and play county cricket, then he played for the West Indies. It's like he never had a break. He just kept going. You know, I think if there was anyone you could say was the Energizer Bunny, just keeps going, definitely. He was incredible. So it goes to show that if you get into your bowling and you do the work and you've got the right body type combined with the right action, then you can keep bowling, you know, day in, day out. Those guys you mentioned, you know, we tried to bowl quick, but we couldn't bowl 100 mile an hour or 160 kilometres an hour. So we're still putting fair stresses on our body. But the guys who bowl 150, 155, 160 kilometres an hour, they put so much stress on their body every ball. And to be a fast bowler, and the action itself is such an unnatural action. So the body needs to be able to cope with those stresses. And you know, you've got to be pretty tough too. You've got to be hard, tough to be a fast bowler. So I think the guys you mentioned had that toughness about them, that they would just keep bowling. Any little niggles, they just bowl through, just push through, and off they'd go. So, yeah, it's finding that balance there. But once you got into the season, I didn't want to have a break. And the guys you mentioned could bowl, you know, over after over, month after month, year after year. So there's a little bit of, yeah, as Tomo said, just get out there and bowl. You know, it worked for those guys.
I read somewhere that Courtney Walsh bowled fast, longer than any man in history.
Yeah, no, he's incredible, Courtney.
The leading fast bowlers today play all three formats, where different skill sets and fitness levels seem to be needed. Stark, Hazelwood, Steyn, Morkel, Rabada, they play even in bilateral limited over series, which are absolutely inconsequential. And the schedule must be taking a real toll on their body and fitness. Is this wise or desirable? Doesn't it all affect longevity and consistency, or blunt their edge, their hostility in test cricket? Shouldn't a policy be formulated by boards, national boards, and also teams to do something about it? All three formats.
It's interesting. There's, you know, as a cricketer, I wanted to play all three formats. They're all totally, all different. You need a different game plan and a different attitude to approach, you know, all three. When I first started my career, I was focused on test cricket. Like I said before, it was the ultimate. And I enjoyed playing one-day cricket, but I didn't take it quite as seriously. And my record showed that. And it wasn't until I sat down and came up with a game plan how I was going to approach one-day cricket. And once I did that, my stats in one-day cricket improved. And I think for T20, it's the same. To be classed a great of the game, I think you need to be able to perform in all three formats and be able to adapt to each different format. I think if you look at the top batsmen at the moment, in Brett Coley, your Joe Roots, Kane Williamson, Steve Smith, they perform test level, one day level, and T20. So to be a quality batsman with a reasonable technique, you can still perform in T20 cricket. You don't have to just be a slogger. So I think the greats will still want to play all forms, but we're going to get to the stage where this guy will play test cricket only. They'll have a test team, they'll have a one-day team, they'll have a T20 team. I think they're there already. So it's just different mentalities. But I also think to come from Australia, we're very lucky. We get the boys get paid quite well playing for Australia. Here in India, the players get paid very well. But countries like the West Indies, New Zealand, that's where the issue is, because they can come play a season, one season of Indian Premier League, and earn more in that season than they can for 5 or 6 years playing for their country, which is pretty tough. So security for your family and everything else does come in and plays a part. But yeah, I think you will see teams, individual teams, just for T20s, just for one day. So specialised teams, but you'll still get players that want to play all three formats and still be successful at all three formats.
You bowled against some of the great batsmen of our time. Who played well against you, and who were your bunnies?
You'd never say, there was batsmen out there that were your bunnies, or you'd get them out for fun. I did get Michael Atherton out a few times.
I think he said that he found the line and the lift extremely difficult to handle.
Yeah, so poor old Athers, I got him out 19 times in 18 tests. So, so yeah, he was, in the end, he was mentally shot, I think. And I do a bit of commentating in the UK and see Athers quite a bit. And all the other commentators do rib him, get stuck into him a bit.
Sachin and Lara,
they're two of the standouts of the time I played, without a doubt. Two totally different batsmen. The only similarity they had, they both stand about this tall. Sachin, though, very technically correct, very mentally strong. Then you had right-handed, Brian Lara, left-handed, very flamboyant, wanted to play all the shots in the world. Always said a little bit mentally unstable, Brian. Brian and I had a bit of a love-hate relationship, though I have spent quite a bit of time with Brian the last 2 years and got to know him really well, and we're good mates now. We get on well, and he even says that I'm not as bad as what he thought I used to be. So maybe that's because we don't play anymore. But
I got him, but he also got big scores against you.
Yeah, so I got I got Sachin out probably 7 or 8 times in Test cricket, and he scored some decent hundreds. But I always felt I could change Sachin's game, that he would wait for a bad delivery, and I just, if I bowled well, I could sort of tie him down a little bit, whereas Brian could never tie him down. He just wanted to play the shots, hit boundaries. I did get him out 15 times in tests, but he did score some big hundreds, big double hundreds against us as well. So I say I wouldn't say it was 50-50. I'd say it was 51% in my favour and 49% in Brian's. But I always enjoyed that challenge, and those guys, were incredible. Brian, just an amazing player. Sachin, 200 test matches, just unbelievable. Nobody will get near him in the history of the game. So they were two standouts. It's hard to go past, Rahul Dravid and Vivesh Lakshman. I vaguely remember a game at, I think it was Eden Gardens, I don't remember it that well, where Rahul and Vivesh batted all day, and it was an incredible performance by those two guys, and we ended up losing that game. If we'd won that game, it would have been 17 wins in a row. The first time we'd won in India for a long time in 2001. But unfortunately for us, it wasn't meant to be. So batsmen on their day can play well, but day in, day out, they're the guys that really stood out from the rest.
If your captain hadn't enforced the follow-on, what would have happened?
well, we never know. If a few things had gone our favour, we could have won, but that's cricket. And it took an amazing performance from those two guys to beat us. I can live with that.
Now, you've seen Kohli bat on television, at least, and he's now batting, like, unbelievably. You must have, you would have relished the challenge, and you must have spotted a flaw or two.
I would have enjoyed the challenge of bowling to Virat, no doubt at all. I got in the lift at the hotel today, and there were some guys in there. I think they enjoyed their cricket, and they're coming out, and they said, oh, I bet you're glad you're not bowling these days. You have to bowl to Virat Kohli, you smash everyone. I said, oh, no, I would have enjoyed the challenge. It is different these days. I think batsmen have a different mentality with the way they approach it, especially in the one-dayers and T20s. To score 380 in a one-dayer and only just defend it, I wonder what the bowlers are doing. When I first started one-day cricket, you could score 200 in the 50 overs and defend it. So game's changed. Though I do remember the first one-day match that India played in was 60 overs. And I think Sunil Gavaskar batted through the innings and remained 36 not out. So I think the game's come a long way, and that's, a batsman can be 36 in two overs these days. But the game has changed. The pitches they play on these days are so good. In Australia, the pitches are so good to bat on. It's a little bit unfair. There's a lot of drop-in wickets. When I first started playing, every ground had a different character. The SCG, you knew, was going to be a wicket that would take spin, would take turn. Perth, at the Wacker, was quick and bouncy. The Gabba was, it looked green and the ball would carry through nicely. Adelaide, good cricket wicket, then day four and five would start to go up and down a little bit. So you had to be able to adapt to all these different wickets. When I finished my career, majority of the wickets were drop-in wickets made of the same soil, same clay, and they performed exactly the same. And I think that's a negative because players in Australia get to play on one type of wicket. They know how to play in those conditions and find it hard to adapt because they never have had to. And I think that's a bit of an issue with world cricket at the moment, where they play so well in their home conditions and they struggle when they go overseas. And unfortunately for Australia, they're definitely in that bag at the moment.
Drop-in pitches have contributed to this.
Yeah, no, the drop-in wickets are just so good these days. They've got a metal frame around the bottom, and they just drop them in. And they don't change. Normally five-day test, you get day one, the pitch is okay. It changes day two, probably quickens up a little bit. Day three gets a bit harder. And day four can start a lot of cracks and start breaking up. So every day is different. But the drop-in pitches these days are so good that playing on day five wicket is like playing on a day two or a day three. There was a test match a few years ago in Melbourne, Boxing Day test match against India when they toured last time. That was the best wicket I've ever seen. It did not change the whole test. If they played a game of cricket every day on that wicket for 5 or 6 weeks, it would have been still a good batting wicket. So I think that too much in the favour of batsmen these days, and plus the bats they use are just amazing. To think, you just miss hit one and it goes 20 rows back over the fence. I wish I had one of those bats. I might have scored a few more runs. But so combination of very good batting conditions, the bats which are bigger but lighter and hit the ball further, I think skill of bowlers have to improve with the game, and I don't think they've caught up with the game just yet.
Now, you mentioned this, teams playing like champions at home and doing very poorly abroad. Just look at the recent test performances of Australia, England and South Africa in Asian conditions. Also the performances of Sri Lanka and South Africa and Pakistan and Australia. That also bears it out. We're waiting for somebody to break this pattern decisively. But the great teams of the past, the West Indies, the 1980s, and the great Australian teams of the past, starting with the Invincibles, defied this pattern. It didn't seem to matter where they played. Can you help us make sense so that you already identified one factor, Australia, these pitches, but how do you make sense of this?
Yeah, no, it's an interesting one, and I think it's a bit of a negative for international cricket. That's where the teams have to improve and have to be able to adapt in different conditions. And I sometimes wonder whether it's T20 coming along that teams just go out there and they want to play their shots. You know, there's no longer, you know, that good, solid defence.
Like boycott, boycott.
Well, yeah, like Boyks, but you'd never wanted to watch Boyks just blocking all day. So, but it's that attitude. Teams, batsmen aren't prepared to go out there and get through the tough periods and look ugly, but be really tough in defence and not play too many shots and get through the tough spells. So that's one of the things. The other one is there's so much cricket going on. When I had two seasons or one and a half seasons, went and played county cricket. So you got to experience other conditions. So when Australians went to England to play in the Ashes series, a lot of the team had played there before, performed well, and knew how to handle the conditions. So it's not quite the same these days. Very few Australian cricketers, if any, go and play county cricket anymore. So whether that's got to do with the, or whether it's just, yeah, they're not prepared to adapt. The way the modern day cricketer plays, that's the way he plays. He's an aggressive batsman. He's going to be aggressive no matter what the conditions. So, yeah, there's got to be it's a bit of a balance there. So, unfortunately, touring teams don't play too well. I think in Australia, the pitches are so good. It's not like the old Australia where it was quick and bouncy and, you know, would seem a lot more. So, I'm looking forward to Australians coming here next month. I'm hoping it'll be a competitive series, but it's going to be tough for the Aussies.
Four tests in February. March.
Their form in the subcontinent has been pretty poor over the last sort of little while.
Now we've already seen that young cricketers play in all formats and play freelance in T20 games across the cricket-playing world. The IPL and the Big Bash are huge successes. And we see young players, both batsmen and bowlers, gravitating to this at the expense of the other formats, Test cricket in particular. Now, imagine you are 23 years old. I mention this because Glenn was a late starter. He made his first class debut when he was almost 23, which was very late. But imagine yourself at that age. What would you have done in this day today?
Yeah, I think growing up in Australia, we still hold Test cricket and receiving the baggy green cap very high. That's still the ultimate for an Australian cricketer, and I hope it will continue on. And you talk to the young guys these days, and they still say that, which is good. So I think in countries like Australia, I like to think of, you know, here in India, Test cricket still held in really high regard by the players. I think where it struggles for countries, as I mentioned before, countries like the West Indies, New Zealand, some other countries like that, where they can go and earn more in 5 or 6 weeks than they can earn in, you know, 3 or 4 years. The West Indies,
Chris Gayle,
a prime example where, you know, I think their board went to them and said, you know, you have to take a pay cut for us to continue, and they had to take an 80% pay cut. So, you know, their Test cricketers or international cricketers weren't being paid much at all, and yet they can go and play county. IPL, the Big Bash, the Caribbean League, all these T20 leagues starting around the world, and earn, you know, 20, 30 times what they can playing Test cricket. So I think that's a big issue for those countries. I think you'll see not so much young cricketers, just you'll see a few young cricketers that aren't good enough to play Test cricket take that road, but I think you'll see Test cricketers retire a little bit earlier, so they can get on that bandwagon. And, you know, I know Shane Watson now plays in around the world in all the different leagues, in the IPL back home, Big Bash, Caribbean League, what's the one in Dubai, Pakistan League, something very similar.
Anyone knows?
Super League, I think, yeah. They're starting up all, so soon you're going to get players that only play one format. But the one thing that I think is a bit of a safety net is, To be paid well in T20, you still have to make a name for yourself. And the only way you really make a name for yourself is representing your country and doing well for your country first, and then the rest comes after that.
So you're happy you didn't have to face that dilemma?
I know I would have still taken the same path that I took. I would have still played test cricket, would have been the ultimate one day cricket, and I would have enjoyed playing T20 cricket as well. So my attitude...
And improved your batting?
If I got some decent cricket bats, would have been good. My cricket bat still had nail holes in it where they took them off the fence and sort of reshaped them, I think. So I had one cricket bat in my bag, and I had some other teammates that said if they ever saw more than two bats, they'd throw all my gear out. I only ever had three batting gloves. Why three, I don't know. I had two right-handers and a left-hander. Why, who knows? Never in my career did I ask for gloves to be brought out. Though I did score 61 in one test match. So yes. I don't know what these batsmen do. They're calling for gloves every second overs. They're a little bit precious, these batsmen. So, but yeah, you know, I would have enjoyed it still.
Now, the reason you are here, Dennis Lilly was nearing the end of his tenure as head of the MRF Base Foundation, everyone is wondering who would he possibly get to succeed him, and I think people were astonished and then delighted that you came. You were persuaded to spend time. So are you happy with the talent you work with at the MRF Peace Foundation? And could you tell us a little bit, take us into your methods, how you help them plan for a game? That would be useful. And also whether there's some potential here that could go up the ladder.
Yeah, no, it's... When I grew up, my hero was Dennis Lilly. So to be asked to take over from Dennis at the MRF Pace Foundation was firstly a big honour. My first and my initial thoughts were no. Coaching was something I never wanted to do. And when I retired, I never wanted to coach, never wanted to commentate. I'm now coaching, I'm now commentating. When my late wife passed away, I was never getting married again, never having any more children. I've been lucky to get married again. I've got a little 16-month-old daughter at home. So the four things I said I would never do again. Never coach, never commentate, never get married, never have... I've done them all. I've decided never say never. Though I have decided I never want to be happy or wealthy. So we'll see how we go. But no, when I was asked to be...
Rahul, a hint.
when I was asked... my initial thoughts were no, but the more I thought about it, I'd been out of the game of cricket for a little while, for roughly 5 years, and I wanted to take a good break from the game because it'd been my life for 20 years. But then I felt, okay, I'm ready to get back in, I'm ready to give something back to the game that's been so good to me, and I thought it was a great opportunity. And so I came over for Dennis's last camp and spent a week over with Dennis just to see how he went about it.
Didn't commit yourself till you saw that.
Yeah, just wanted just to get a feel for it and just see if it was something I... Because I didn't know how to coach. I thought the way I play came naturally. I thought everyone else had the same attitude, but I didn't know how to teach someone how to bowl. Well, so much the technical side, the mental side and the thought processes was something that that was my strength, whereas the technical side, probably not so much. So I come over just to get a bit of a feel and just see how things sort of were run here. I came here in 1992, the first time the Australians actually came over to do some work at the MRF Pace Foundation. So that was 25 years ago. So it's been quite a while since I was there. And I was so impressed. You know, Dennis to me is still one of the best, if not the best, fast bowling coach in the world. And what I've learned from him has been amazing. But just to see how the MRF goes about it, the facilities they have here, the coaching staff, Central, our head coach, to me, still is one of the best bowling coaches I've come across as well.
Technically, Central?
So Central's just here, and what I've... Yeah. I've been very lucky to have Central there with me. What I've learned from Dennis and especially from Central in respects to the technical side of coaching has helped me to know, and I wish I knew what I knew now when I was playing. I could have fixed my action up and maybe taken a few more wickets, so... But
or bowled worse.
Maybe swung the ball a bit more. Maybe bowled a bit quick. No, but anyway. But I was so impressed, and I thought, you know, maybe I do have a bit to offer in respects to coaching. And so over the last 4 and a bit years, I've really enjoyed it. And I hopefully I've passed on a bit to the young guys coming through as much as I've learnt. And I think the day you stop learning, whatever you do is the day to give that away. And I've still learned a lot about fast bowling in the last 4 years. And I feel I've got a lot to offer the game. So no, I've enjoyed it. I think the way the MRF go about it, it's a great setup, as I said, for the young guys coming in to learn, to live, eat, breathe cricket, especially fast bowling, to get fit, get strong, to improve their actions, and then the mental side of the game, just their thought processes, how they prepare for a game, the routines, and also how they, their game plans in a match and their thought processes in a match, how they look to set batsmen up, how do they look to get batsmen out, to build pressure, all those things I think is great for any young cricketer, young fast bowler coming in. Hopefully it'll fast track their journey into first class cricket and hopefully up to the Indian level. So I'm always impressed by the young bowlers we have, and cricket in India is so much different to anywhere in the world. There's just a real love, real passion for the game, and I'm always impressed with the young guys. A couple that have really stood out recently in this last season, two guys, one Ashwin Christ, who's here tonight, and also Vignesh.
Where is
Ashwin Christ. So Ashwin played 10 Ranji Trophy games, took 35 wickets. Vignesh played 9, took 37. So, that's impressive, doing so well at it. First-class level here in India. So, it's good to see those guys doing well. And, there's been 18 guys, full-time students at the MRF that have gone on and represented their country. So, and hopefully in years to come, we'll see more and more continuing going on representing Australia. So, hopefully with a combination of technical skills, mental strength and thought processes, and we keep telling them the best coach they'll have is themselves. So, we hope they learn about their game, about their bowling, know themselves well, but not only improve themselves as cricketers, but also as people and as young men. So I'm really enjoying my time here. It is like a second home here in Chennai, but very lucky to have someone like Raul Marmon sort of in charge of the MRF Pace Foundation, and also Central and the other coaches and support staff we have. So that the young boys are very lucky to have these guys.
Yeah, Varun, I read a report. Varun Aran, in a few minutes you helped him. You found him stiff in his run-up and told him, you have an insight. So you're probably underestimating yourself.
I think between Central and I, we came up with that. But, yes, I've always sort of, when I played, it was about, how I went about it and thought processes and sort of, so now when I watch bowlers, I not only look at how I think, what they're thinking and how they're delivering, I look at their techniques now. So, with Varun, to be a fast bowler, you have to stay nice and relaxed. The more tense you are, the slower you bowl, the more you muscle it. And it's like a batsman, if he's tense, he's not going to bat well. So you've got to stay relaxed. And Varun was sort of, he wasn't using his momentum and just sort of pick his feet up a bit and run with a little bit more intent.
Now at the top level of cricket, people seem to be very willing to help others, even the opponents, even people on the other side. If a fast bowler asked you during the height of your career for tips, would you withhold a lot of your knowledge or would you be helpful?
No, I'd be happy to have a chat with him. I know some guys that say, come back at the end of the series and I'll tell you, because I don't want to give you any tips I remember the stories back. You mentioned Geoffrey Boycott before, and a few stories from Dennis Lilly and Rod Marsh and those guys. If they were playing England, there was one batsman that was performing really well. Those days, after every day's play, they used to go into the opposition team in the room and have a drink and socialise with them. So they'd go in, they'd go up to Geoffrey Boycott and say, "Oh, such and such is batting so well. He looks great." And Geoffrey Boycott would go, "That's because you're not bowling to him properly. You need to bowl it here." And so he'd tell them how to bowl it, next day, knock them over. So there's that Yeah, there's a fine balance here. You don't want to give information on how to get your team out. I would never say you need to bowl this way to Steve Waugh, Ricky Ponting, Matty Hayden, Adam Gilchrist, but for a fast bowler, you know, a technical question or you know, certain delivery, I was always happy to help him.
Before we... I invite the audience to ask their questions, comments. Please keep it brief, no speeches. Could you tell us something about an update on the McGrath Foundation? The work it does in the field of breast cancer support and education.
Yeah, no, I guess the story starts back in 1997 when my late wife was first diagnosed with breast cancer, and it was, you know, our world was turned upside down. And we went through from diagnosis through surgery, through treatment, through radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and it was a pretty tough journey to get through. But somehow we got through it. My late wife had an amazing strength. And then we went on to have two very happy, healthy children. But after my son James was born, we were approached to write a book telling our journey through breast cancer, telling it from my wife's perspective and also from mine. We thought about it for a while, and my late wife Jane in the end said, if it helps one person by us telling our story, then it's worthwhile. So we decided to write the book. They wanted to give a certain amount of the proceeds or profits to a charity or foundation of our choice. And we thought it'd be nice to have a little bit of control over where that money went. So that was where an idea of first setting a charity or a foundation up. In 2003, she had a recurrence. And the main difference this time was that there was a breast care nurse there. And the difference that made in our lives, but especially Jane's, was incredible. So we relaunched as a McGrath Foundation in 2005. With two very clear objectives. One was to raise awareness of breast cancer, especially in younger women, and also to raise funds to place breast care nurses in communities right across the country. It was Jane's dream, and it's still our goal that every family going through breast cancer has access to a breast care nurse where they live. So that was important to her. That's still important to us. You can self-refer, and it's a totally free service, which is what we wanted also. Unfortunately, Jane lost a battle in 2008. At that time, we had four nurses employed. Today, it costs about $130,000 a year to put a nurse on with everything that goes with it, wages on top of everything else. And we don't put a nurse unless we have 3 years' funding up front. So it equates to about $390,000. As I sit here now, we now have 117 nurses. And they've supported more than 50,000 families back home, and hearing those numbers just blows me away. We need to double our number of nurses in the next 5 years to get to where we want to get to, but the support's been absolutely incredible, and you only have to look at the Sydney Test match. Well, it's nearly the Sydney Pink Test now, where people come along and support. Everything's in pink. Both teams, the home and away team, have pink logos on their shirts. Day three... It's really the whole test, but day three is our big one. And everyone comes dressed in pink to see the whole stadium in pink. It's quite amazing. So I'm pretty busy that day, so I have to take 5 or 10 minutes just to look around and take in the enormity of it all. It's quite amazing, and I do view myself a very lucky person. There's been some really tough times in my life, without a doubt, and... It sort of puts life in perspective when you go through those things and you realise what's important. And what's important is the people in your life, your close friends and your family. And so it was a bit of a wake-up call in that respect. But like I said, I think I'm very lucky. I think everyone has their own battles and challenges to face, and it's how you pick yourself up and continue on. And I've had some great people in my life, and now to have met my wife Sarah... Yeah, my two children. She does. She loves it here. She wants to move and live here. We haven't quite got to that stage yet. But my eldest son is 17. He turned 17 today. And my eldest daughter.
So what did you do for him?
I rang, and my wife rang at 4:30 this morning. Actually at midnight. Firstly, and then 4:30 again, but anyway. And I wished him happy birthday. He was flying up to Brisbane to stay with some friends up there and spend a week up there. And then my other daughter, Holly, is 15, And then my youngest daughter is 16 months old. So we've got a very happy, very healthy family, which is nice. And I know Jane's looking down. She'd be really happy with the way her family's going. She'd be really proud of the foundation and what it's achieving and the way it's making a positive difference in people's lives. It does keep me busy, but I feel I'm a lucky person and felt a sense of responsibility to give back to people that haven't been as lucky as I have. So, you know, it's going well. The support's amazing. It just blows me away, and yeah, really proud of what the foundation's achieving.
We have about 25 minutes, a little more. But let me say, aren't we lucky to have Glenn McGrath here?
Great cricketer, wonderful person.
Questions? Please introduce yourself and then Murali.
Glenn, my name is Murali. Thank you very much for your illuminating insights. You are also entertaining. And let me make a disclaimer upfront. I've been an unabashed supporter and admirer of Australian cricket from my school days. And therefore, I hope what I'm going to say won't be taken amiss. The supporters and enthusiasts of other cricketing teams always confront me with this embarrassing and difficult question on the culture of or sporting spirit of the Australian teams over the years, saying they are bad losers, they are not good sports, they are sledgers, they sledge more than any other team, and so on. I find it very difficult to counter that or answer them, though I continue to support Australia. One recent incident...
He supports Australia against India.
Latest incident which even appalled me also was, you know, the team selection, Matthew Wade was taken in place of the much better wicketkeeper and also maybe a batsman, better batsman, Peter Neville, all for increasing the noise level, which is a euphemism for sledging. So isn't that a bad thing?
Firstly, you know, thank you for supporting Australian cricket. I have to disagree with you in respects to bad losers and bad sportsmanship. I think there's no bigger insult you can say to an Australian that he's a bad sport or he's a bad loser. We do play our sport. We have a lot of passion, a lot of energy. The Australian way is we're very upfront. You know, if we're going to say something to another team, we don't try to hide it or go about it in a sneaky way. It's just the way we are. We play it hard and tough, and we like to think fair in the middle, and everyone's friends as soon as they walk off. That's the way it should be. Let me tell you first that Australians aren't the only ones that sledge in world cricket. When the Australian team was number one in the world, I think there was nothing else any other team or media could say against us. So they always picked this, they always said sledging, you know, they always try to make a big thing of it. So the media has to, I think, have a part to play. Every team I played had chat out in the middle, let me tell you that. Even India. I was sledged by Sachin Tendulkar as well, so don't worry about that. Not too many batsmen sledged me, but Sachin... in English. I let me tell you, I could understand exactly what he was saying. I have read in his book what he said. Slightly different to what I remembered, but that's okay. And so,
who's the worst
in the Australian team or around the world? In the Australian team, Matthew Hayden was probably the worst, but he was hiding at in gully, and you'd never see him. We always had a few run-ins with. I remember Juna Ranatunga and the Sri Lankans and what have you.
We have here the former manager of the Sri Lankan cricket team, Chandra Shaft.
But in Arjuna's defence, what he did for the team in 1996 and then was incredible, and they went on to win the World Cup there, so you can't take it away from him. But Steve Waugh changed the term. He didn't like the term sledging. He called it gamesmanship. It sounds so much better, doesn't it? So, but you mentioned culture. You know, growing up, it's funny. We always have a bit of chat. you know, with your mates. When we play against our friends, any sport, you're always having a go at them. And it's just our culture. We never mean it. It's never meant personally. It's all just to get in the other person's mind and just have a bit of fun with them. And I know when I go out to my brother on his farm, when his mates come in, there's worse sledging there than you'll ever see in the field. But it's all because, yeah, everyone's mates, they know how to take it. So, because funnily enough, I was a few years ago when I was in England commentating, they brought up this whole the Australian sledging thing again. And I thought, it's you know, it can't be right. So I asked Michael Vaughan, who was ex-captain of England, are the Australians really the worst sledging team in the world? And he said no. He said they're not bad, but there's still teams that are worse than they were. And apologies, he did say Sri Lanka was the worst team, but I don't know if it was just Sri Lanka-England rivalry there, but out in the middle. But, well, you have to ask the Sri Lankans that they didn't get caught like the Australians. But no, it was funny. If we played India or we played Sri Lanka, we always noticed that they would say something to us, but no one would see them. And if we responded, they'd run off to the umpire going, "Oh, dirty words." So, it's sort of different cultures and the way they go. From an Australian perspective, it's never meant personally. It's just to get in their mind. It's funny. At home, we've got a table tennis table, and I play table tennis against my wife, and she used to be a good tennis player, and she goes pretty well. But as soon as I start a little bit of chat, and she goes to water, she can't handle it. So it's to get in the other person's mind. But there are some players that if you have a bit of a chat to, that they focus and they'll never get them out. Got one guy, you know, Brian Lara, if you had a chat to him, you'd never get... He could focus and you knew you were never getting him out. I remember an occasion when Dean Jones asked Curtly Ambrose to take his white armbands off, had a bit of a go at him. Curtly went out and took 6 wickets for one run after that. So you can't just, you know, have a chat to anyone. But, yeah, it's never meant personally. It's just the way the Australians play, where we play hard, tough, but fair cricket in the middle. We're happy to cop it. And that's one thing the Australians do well. They'll take sledging, they'll give it as well, but then they'll never mention anything off the field.
And I think it's racist.
Even then, the times when it has, if there's anything happened like that, it's never been ignored, but it's never been taken any further for some reason. So, but that's a difference. The Australians will play hard and tough. If there's chat in the middle, they won't talk about it off the field, whereas other teams do that and make a big thing in the media. So that's what I find disappointing. But to call an Australian a bad sport, a cheat, or a bad loser is the biggest insult you can do. So we do take a lot of pride in the way we are and the way we play our game. We play it hard and tough in the middle. International sport, international cricket, test cricket should be a test. It should be hard. It should be tough. It should be a test of skill, of fitness, of strength, and mental strength as well. So, you know, that's the way we go about it. And I think Australia's a pretty good... We don't like losing, but I think we're pretty good losers and we're also pretty good winners. We're not sort of bad winners, or I don't think we're bad losers. So, but that's the way we play.
I am a true ardent admirer of the Australian approach, personally. I would want to check with you whether do you see any fundamental difference in the infrastructure between Australia and India? And what's your thoughts on improving the methods of training for the Indian fast bowlers as well as their approach, including the mental approach?
Did you mean first-class cricket in India and Sri Lanka? In Australia?
Yeah.
India and Australia? It's been an interesting approach this last season to play at neutral venues. I think that's probably made a little bit better for fast bowlers these days. But at the end of the day, you've got to be able to adjust and adapt to the conditions. So I haven't been around first-class cricket enough in India. I see our boys go and play, so I don't know the system well enough to really totally comment. I think for young fast bowlers with their attitude and their training regimes and everything else, come and try it for the MRF Pace Foundation. We can pass on all that for you there. But, yeah, I think the one thing that I noticed when I played Indian Premier League, and you know, being involved, playing alongside guys I'd only ever played against, it didn't matter whether you're from Australia, from England, from India, from Sri Lanka, from the West Indies, Pakistan, South Africa, wherever you're from, cricketers are very similar in their approach. They have a love for the game. They like to go out there, perform at their best. There was a synergy between everyone. I used to think every team was different, the way they went about things, but there's not that much difference. And that's what I enjoyed about the IPL, getting to know guys I don't even played against and realise that there's not a huge difference there. And so I think fast bowlers anywhere in the world, you know, they've got to, they have a certain skill level. They have to have a certain fitness, certain strength level. That will take them so far. It's the attitude that will take them the rest of the way, their mental strength, their self-belief, what they're prepared to do, their work ethic, all those things. That's what will stand out a good cricketer to a great cricketer, and that's at any level. You need a skill level, but it's the attitude that will take you the rest of the way. So
that's what they
need. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Praveen from Priya. Now, I'm making the response that you gave to the previous questioner and the jet boycott story. Those days, yes, you had to go across, buy drinks, but now you played IPL. You played, you're part of the Big Bash as well, which means there's no international team per se, it's a mixture. And you, by default, you go and tell your captain how the other batsman is going to play. So it's kind of an open book right now, in terms of strategy or how to get a batsman out or how to read about that. So how do you think the new gen copes with it?
Yeah, no, it's a good question, but so playing alongside other guys, you get to know how they play and how they perform and how to get them out. But this day and age with technology, everyone knows how you're going to bowl. Everyone knows how they're going to bat. I can't remember going into a test match without having individual bowling plans to this batsman, that batsman, and this batsman. And so really, there's no secrets. Okay? You don't learn that much talking to other players because you probably can tell them more anyway. So with technology these days, unless you've never seen a bowler bowl or a batsman bat, there's no secrets anymore. And it's interesting, you always see the first season for a fast bowler, even a spinner, batsman, if they have a standout season for their first year, their second year is always tougher because all of a sudden, batsmen know how this bowler's going to bowl. Bowlers know how this one batsman goes about it. So if they can perform well in their first series, first year, great. If they can perform in their second, even better. And then off they go. So with technology these days, there's not too many more secrets.
What kind of things do you learn as a bowler?
If you haven't seen a batsman before and you're watching footage of them, you'll go through, you know, where their strengths are. You see them, you know, playing the cut shot. Okay, they're good when the ball gets... They stand back. They're more a back foot player. Okay, we need to get a little bit fuller. Or they're a front foot player. Okay, we can be allowed to be a little bit shorter. But you also go through their dismissals, how they've been dismissed, their false shots, their play and misses. Like, you can type in all balls, you know, on off, hit the deck, top of off stump, to two, you know, you can type in that ball and see every ball that batsman's faced on that delivery and see how he goes. You type in something else, you can see, and vice versa, you can see what majority of the balls this guy bowls and how he goes about it. So just by watching, you get a bit of an idea. Okay, this guy's a front foot player, a back foot player. They don't like the short ball. They don't like the full ball, things like that. They get out majority of the time, LBW. Shane Watson, he'd plant the front foot and then sort of bat would come around, hit in the pad, he'd get out LBW. So you can watch footage these days and it's there. So to have a chat to someone, like the old days when Boyks played, there was no footage like that. They didn't have the technology, but now it's there.
I'm Deepak. I would like to know, you were just talking about how touring teams have become rather poor at touring. Would you say the lack of two matches, we used to have 5-6 three-day or four-day matches which preceded a test match. We don't have it now. Is it causing a lot of impact and therefore the scheduling of the tours itself?
No, I'd have to agree with you there. With so much cricket being played these days and tournaments you mentioned earlier where one-day tournament thrown in or a T20 tournament thrown in, which really at the end of the day doesn't mean a huge amount. But what it does is it makes the rest of the schedule, the scheduling really tight. So you go, you may play one tour match before you go into a test series, which isn't enough. The days when you go and play two and three games or more, it would really allow you to get into the adapt to the conditions, be able to adapt and adjust to the conditions, and off you go. I remember hearing about the Ashes tour when Australia went to England. They would play every single county on that tour. Now they play two or three, and that's it. So it does mean that the tour's gone from 4 to 5 months down to, you know, a couple of months, and it's scheduling that does it. It's
not Abraham, yeah. The Indian team, for example, invariably loses the first test match very badly, and then we pick up the threads of how to play. Had we scheduled a couple of matches, I think the series would be, you know, much more even. Same is the case for all other touring teams.
No, exactly right, and I think that plays a big part in allowing teams to adapt and adjust to the conditions. So it makes it a lot tougher, especially come from Australia to India, go from India to Australia. It is a lot more difficult, definitely. And that is one of the reasons why teams don't play well overseas.
Hello, Glenn. My name is Praveen. The Australian team is going to tour India very soon. So who do you think will face a bigger challenge? The Australian batsmen or the Australian bowlers trying to get the Indian batsmen out?
Probably both. The way the Indian batsmen are going at the moment, you know, they're playing incredibly well, led by Virat Kohli. So to play India in Indian conditions, the batsmen just know it so well, and to come from Australian wickets pitchers here bowling on, our strength have always been our fast bowlers, so they have to bowl well here. Mitchell Stark, to me, I think holds the key. If he can bowl well, you know, we're half a chance to bowl well here, then it's up to the spinners. But the biggest issue, I think, is our batsmen against the Indian bowlers, more so the spin bowlers. Australia's never been great players of spin. I think back to someone like Matthew Payden, who wasn't very good at playing spin, and then once he learned how to sweep and swept very well, that he performed so much better in conditions over here. So I think our batsmen, the Australian batsmen, need to be able to play a sweep shot and execute it very well. If they do that, then they're half a chance of scoring runs. In the past, I think Australians are very attacking. They like to hit down the ground. They use their feet sometimes. We've either gone too aggressive or too defensive, so they haven't found that balance. So if they can sweep well, there might be half a chance, but they're up against it. I don't think Australia's won a test match in India since probably 2004. I'm not sure. So it's been... So to me, that tells me they're due to win some.
Glenn?
Yeah, Mike here.
No, here. Yeah, hi, Glenn. This is Bhagavati Prasad. There's a point that in the recent years, whenever Australia has toured to a subcontinent country, there's so much talk about the coaching staff, the preparations, coming into the Australian team. Recently, we had Ricky Ponting, there's Darren Lehman, Brad Haddin, then Jasin Langer. There's too much of changes in the coaching setup and too much of emphasis on the preparation part alone during a subcontinent series. Do you think, what is the sort of an impact that does have on a playing unit? No, there are a lot of coaches, a lot of inputs given, a lot of talk, this, that. How much of a fact is that affecting the players actually? Do you think that is helping, or is it the process, the so-called process, and not much about the results?
Yeah, it's interesting to see, you know, what the true impact it is. I think they're there to help players, but I think players need to take it on themselves and learn as much and sort of, you know, take responsibility for themselves. You know, when I first started playing, we had a coach, a physio and a manager. That was it. And we were still winning games of cricket. I remember England came to Australia a little while ago and got beaten 5-0. And they had, I think, nearly two support staff to every player. So obviously it didn't make a difference. So it's finding that balance there. You know, it's fine to provide everything for the players, but it's still up to the players themselves to get out there and do the business and be hard, be tough, focus on that. Sometimes the media can, you know, take things away from the match itself. So players, when they get there, they should just try to adapt to the conditions, not read all the media or listening to what's happening around them. But, you know, to have specific batting coaches, to have specific bowling coaches, it's there to help the players. But I think at that level, players don't need coaches. They need more sort of managers. Okay, just provide the right things here because they should know their game very well. For me personally, when I played, I knew my game very well. If I had any issues, I'd ask the senior players more so than anyone else. So it's got to be a happy balance there, but it's up to the players to take responsibility of their performances in the middle without saying, you know, blaming support staff or the media or what have you.
Yeah. Glenn, hi, I'm Suman. Do you see in the next 5 or 10 years the cricket world actually starting to shrink? Because the West Indies is running through a huge crisis as far as cricket goes. Even in Sri Lanka now, after Sangakkara, Jayawardena and Murali left, they're sort of rebuilding and it's sort of struggle going on there. South Africa, where again, you know, with their new rules and policies and so on, they're having a problem. I want to contrast it with football, for instance. Yeah, okay, the BCCI also has a problem, but I mean, it's a different kind of problem. But
we find out soon what's going to happen there.
Yeah. So, do you see the cricket world shrinking? I want this to bring this contrast with football, for instance, where the 2026 World Cup is going to have 48 teams. And in the last 15 years or 20 years of cricket, if you exclude possibly Afghanistan, I mean, Bangladesh, assume they came in earlier, you've not really had any team sort of emerge in the cricket world. So, is the cricket world shrinking? And what should the ICC do to change it?
Yeah, it's interesting, and I remember when T20 cricket first came about in the first couple of seasons of IPL, I was a little bit concerned of the negativity it would have on Test cricket. And I remember the second IPL was in South Africa. I was sitting in a cafe with Matthew Hayden, and I voiced my concerns. And he came up with a different side. He thought T20 cricket was great for the game of cricket. One, it would bring more people to the game, because it's a quicker, faster, exciting game that, you know, people that don't watch Test cricket. And it's got the ability to take cricket to countries that don't play. Other European countries, you know, the North American, other countries that don't play. So the T20 has, I think, the ability to make it to bring more teams from around the world in. Whether the way the ICC are looking at the next World Cup, where they're saying less teams will be played in it, I don't necessarily agree with that. I think they should always, you know, the way Afghanistan, for argument's sake, played last, the World T20, I thought was great. You want more teams playing cricket around the world, and the more countries get involved, the better. But I think we don't realise exactly how many countries are playing cricket around the world. I was surprised when I found out. They play cricket in Italy, you know, obviously in Canada, US, all these countries where I didn't think they played cricket. And, we think it's only sort of 12, 15, but it's more like 60 to 80 countries around the world play cricket. So with T20 cricket, hopefully you'll get more people playing, more people watching, and then just see how they go about playing international tournaments or World Cups and really get more teams involved.
Hi, Glenn. My name is Srinath. I have two questions. One, that you were talking about the dominance of bat over ball. So what do you feel would be the ideal things that ICC or anybody can do with to reduce this dominance or to have more emphasis on bowling? And the second question is primarily with respect to the reverse swing as such. So we don't see reverse swing bowling, a quality of reverse swing as what we saw in your days or Wasi Akram, or I think in India it ended with latest with Zahir Khan. I don't see the quality of reverse swing being emphasized across.
Yeah, so to answer the first question, I think the rules of one-day cricket have changed quite a bit since I was playing to now, up until 40 overs, only you have to have 5 inside the circle. Makes a big difference. They're bringing the ropes so far in. We mentioned the bats earlier and the wickets being, the pitches being so good. Bowlers have to be able to adapt and increase their skill level, I mentioned earlier. Whether they put the ropes out a bit further or allow an extra bat fieldsman outside the circle. Well, I was starting to think maybe they should allow a fieldsman to field in the crowd. Yeah, take some catches out there. But seriously, I think bowlers have to lift their skill level. That's the main issue I see, because I think they're not going to make the grounds bigger. There's safety issues by not allowing the fence to be the fence anymore. Bats, they're now limiting how wide a bat can be, or how thick a bat can be, I should say. So there's a few things there. Whether the rules of the game will change much as it is, we'll wait and see. In respects to reverse swing only really has an effect now in Test cricket. T20, you know, 20 overs, you're not really going to get the ball swinging. Plus, in one-day games, they use two balls. So you don't get, the ball doesn't get old enough to allow the reverse swing. So I think that's a bit of an issue. But at Test cricket, we still have Mitchell Starc, bowls really good reverse swing. There's other bowlers around the world that bowl good reverse swing. So, but you know, when you're talking like guys like Wasim Akram, you know, Waqar Yunus, you know, they were two of the, Waqar Yunus was one of the best of reverse swings. So it's there's still decent bowlers out there.
Glenn?
Okay, two more. Very quickly, one
yeah.
And last.
Glenn here. Recently, in the last 5 years or before that, Bhagavati Prasad. In the one days, we had a super sub rule. There's been a lot of talk in Test now how to improve Test cricket or bring crowd into Test cricket or make it interesting. Do you think the super sub rule could actually help improve Test cricket? Supposing if an Australian team plays in India and you have a super sub role, you can have a spinner as a super sub and bring him into play in the fourth or fifth day. Do you think there's a case for that super sub rule in Test cricket?
Well, it's interesting to see which way they go. You probably, you know, super sub would be a bowler, it'd allow you to carry an extra batsman. I remember in the domestic one-day games in Australia when I first started playing, they brought in that rule and you played 12. So I was the guy that didn't bat. So it was perfect. I'd turn up to the game. I'd walk in carrying my boots. I didn't have to worry about any other cricket gear. It would allow the team to strengthen their bowling a bit and their batting. Whether that would mean you'd score more runs or less, we'll wait and see. It's not a bad idea. I didn't mind the concept when we played back in domestic cricket, whether it's a way forward. Test cricket, not so sure. I think Test cricket... I'm very much a traditionalist. I like to be left the way it is. I don't mind the day-night test matches. It's quite good. But to change the rules any further, I'm not a big fan. Whereas one day is T20, it's got that potential. Of course, I remember it's amazing to see where T20's gone to. My first international T20 match was in Eden Park in New Zealand, in Auckland. And the Kiwis came out. If you remember back in the World Series, they had their really light brownie with the dark brown. They wore the old strips and they all had big curly wigs on. And it was a bit of a hit and giggle. We didn't take it very seriously. It was a bit of fun. I pretended to bowl underarm delivery, which I got red carded by the umpire, Billy Bowden. And it was just really good fun spirit. And now it's very serious. So it's come a long way in that space of time. But you know, you can tamper a little bit more with the rules of T20 one day, as I think. I wouldn't like to see Test cricket change too much.
Hello, sir. My name is Chujoy. Sir, whom do you consider to be the most destructive batsman that you have played against? And two, Sehwag versus Gilchrist. Who do you think is a better hitter of the ball? You have played alongside both, so you would be in a good position to answer that.
Yeah, no, it's those two guys are up there pretty destructive. Andrew Simons, again, very destructive. Brian Lara, on his day, he was a guy that, you know, I think he would have played well with the mentality of T20 cricket these days. If he was coming through, I think Brian Lara would be one of the best T20 cricketers going around. Sehwag, you know, he played Test cricket like he played one day as like he played T20, didn't he? So he wasn't a guy you wanted to bat for too long if you're bowling to him. But I didn't mind bowling to Viru. I think my style of bowling where I'd hit just on off stump, just outside, it would seam back into the stumps. Viru would pick up the line very early. He'd go to try to hit me over the top. It would seam back into off stump or into his pad. So I didn't mind bowling to Viru in that respect. Some days he He hit us everywhere. Adam Gilchrist, for a guy coming in batting seven, to have a guy like him in our team was a luxury not many other teams had. And if he batted for, if he was there for an hour or two, he either took the game away from the opposition or got us back into the game. You know, but they weren't slogs, they were proper cricket shots, but he just hit the ball so well. And Andrew Simons, he was a guy that, you know, probably hit the ball harder than anyone else. If the cricket ball felt pain, it felt more pain from Andrew Simons hitting it than I think many other batsmen. So on their day, anyone, but day in, day out, those guys that I mentioned would be definitely up there. And Viru, in respects to Indian cricketers, I think he was up there with probably the most destructive batsman going around.
On that note, I think we must close. We haven't asked him yet about DRS and so on, but next time. So over to Chennai International Centre.
So thank you, Glenn. You passed the test. You answered all Mr. Ram's questions very well. So thank you, Mr. Ram. We enjoyed the session. And in terms of the next event, it's on February 8th. And we'd also like to thank the Madras School of Economics for hosting us again today. So see you on February 8th. Thank you.
Thank you.